this week on Christian World News, the year in review. In 2013, raging mobs destroyed more than 60 churches in Egypt, but the Christians swear they will forgive their attackers. Plus, despite international pressure, Pastor Saeed Abedini remains in an Iranian prison. How his family is continuing to fight for his release while they cope with his absence. And the Philippines takes a double blow, first an earthquake, then a massive typhoon. How the church came to their rescue. These stories and more in our look back at 2013. Welcome to this special year in review edition of Christian World News. I'm Wendy Griffith. 2013 was a harsh year for one of the world's oldest churches. Egypt's Christian community dates back to the first century. This summer, Muslim mobs, angry at the ouster of Islamist President Mohamed Morsi, attacked scores of churches across the nation. Dozens of them were destroyed. One Egyptian scholar called it the worst violence against the Coptic Church since the 14th century. Middle East Bureau Chief Chris Mitchell has this report from Egypt.
This is the Emir Tadros Church in Minya, just one of the dozens of churches that have been destroyed throughout Egypt. This is a 100-year-old church, and as you can see, it's been completely destroyed on the inside. One Egyptian expert said the violence against the churches in Egypt is the worst in nearly 700 years.
This exclusive video, aired for the first time on nationwide TV, shows the inside of the sanctuary is completely gutted and the altar destroyed.
To be sure that everything is burned, they put fire in every place. Before this time, they make a sign for Christian places or cars or houses or buildings, and if the place has an X on it, they burn the place.
Now the church uses this makeshift altar outside, and the pastor explained to us they started holding their services at 6:30 in the morning. The churches weren't the only targets. Schools, cars, and businesses owned by Christians were destroyed. Perhaps most shocking was the destruction of this Christian orphanage.
This is a Coptic Christian orphanage called Christ Soldiers. Muslim mobs came in here and they destroyed the building, leaving about 200 children without shelter. But they wanted to leave a message for the attackers, and they wrote it on the wall outside. And it said, "You meant to hurt us, but we forgive you. God is love. Everything works out for good."
They also wrote, "Love your enemies." Evangelical ministries bore the brunt of many attacks. This is what remains of the bookstore in Minya of the Bible Society of Egypt. Their store in nearby Eshut was also destroyed. Those bookstores used to look like this one. Now the Bibles, Christian books, and children's materials are in shambles.
For the last 130 years, we have been operating. We have bookshops in the streets, in main cities, in Cairo, Alexandria, Tanta, Upper Egypt, and it has never happened in the history of the Bible Society.
According to this Egyptian website, more than 60 churches were attacked from Minya, Alexandria, Giza, Suez, and throughout Egypt.
We do every effort to be self-restrained and to show the Christian love that the Lord has taught us to show.
The churches are asking for prayer and support from the church worldwide.
They can pray for us all the time, ask Jesus to save us.
They say the buildings have been destroyed, but the church goes on, and their faith remains in Jesus Christ, who promised he would build his church. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Minya, Egypt.
September saw the deadliest terror attack against Christians in the history of Pakistan. 85 Christians died and more than 140 were injured in an attack on a church in Peshawar. A pair of suicide bombers blew themselves up as hundreds of worshipers were leaving Sunday service. The Pakistani Taliban claimed responsibility. Thousands of Christians took to the streets demanding the government do more to protect them. Christians are caught in the middle of serious civil war. Sunni-led Muslim rebels have repeatedly shelled Christian neighborhoods in Damascus, and they're targeting Christian towns and villages. Christian refugees report atrocities by rebel forces, including rape and murder. Also, Al-Qaeda-linked fighters have desecrated churches in areas that they have seized. The Syrian war saw the worst humanitarian crisis since the days of the Rwandan genocide. According to the United Nations, Syrian refugee numbers grew to an alarming 2 million. Relief agency efforts to help them neared a breaking point. Many of the refugees are Christians who are now struggling to survive in neighboring countries. Our Gary Lane visited some of them and files this report.
5,000 people are now fleeing Syria each day. Their numbers have grown from 250,000 a year ago to more than 2 million today.
It's the worst humanitarian crisis in the world today, and they've sought refuge in places like this camp. This is in Lebanon in the Bekaa Valley, not far from the Syrian border.
Each have experienced hardship, suffering, or death. Their churches, homes, and livelihood have been destroyed. Many Christians like Nicholas George have lost family members. He owned a small grocery store in Syria, but fled to Lebanon because the war caused his business to fail.
Because of the fighting, everyone in my area was stuck inside their house. They could not buy anything. It was very dangerous for me even to try to open my shop.
Nicholas and his family now live in a small two-room apartment in the Bekaa Valley. He's found some part-time work making cinder blocks at a brick factory. His salary only gives him enough money to pay the rent and buy a small amount of food. But he also suffers from diabetes. He must often choose between buying food or medicine.
I'm always worried about my medicine. I feel weak and dizzy when I'm without it.
Some American Christians gave Nicholas enough money to purchase a three-month supply of medicine. He says when it runs out, he'll need to rely on the generosity of suffering family members still residing in Syria to send help. CBN partner Heart for Lebanon learned about Nicholas's struggles. He's now among Syrian refugees receiving monthly food supplies. We caught up with Heart for Lebanon workers as they distributed food to Syrian Christian refugees in Zale. CBN News also accompanied them as they visited a number of refugee homes. So, as an escalating crisis is expected to cause more Syrians to flee their country, and as host countries struggle to assist them, CBN and partner Heart for Lebanon are working together to alleviate some of the suffering.
Their help is making life easier for us, and I'm now reading the Bible more and attending church regularly here. My faith in Jesus is stronger.
Partners sharing the love of Christ with those who don't know Him, and bringing help and encouragement to strengthen the faith of those who do. Gary Lane, CBN News, Zale, Lebanon.
Coming up, a family waits and prays. While Pastor Saeed Abedini serves time in an Iranian prison, his wife is fighting for his release.
Hello, I'm Terry Newsom. Did you know there are more than 148 million orphans in the world today? 148 million. But it was three little girls that taught me about the plight of orphans. 8 years ago, my husband and I spent nearly a month immersed in the daily activities of a Ukrainian orphanage as we waited to adopt three sisters. I saw firsthand the utter loneliness, the pain of rejection, and the overwhelming desire to be loved. That experience changed me forever. And out of it grew a ministry from my heart called Orphans Promise. Today, we're helping orphans and vulnerable children in more than 50 countries worldwide. Thousands of children are now in safe homes. They're being educated, and they're learning life skills. I'm asking you to join with me and become family to these children. Will you call the number on your screen right now? Because every child deserves a chance to be happy.
Inside every child is a hero, a leader, a friend to others, someone who helps out, who does the right thing, who dreams of what they can be, but they still need our help.
What should I do?
What should I say?
How should I feel?
That's where Superbook comes in. It provides moral and spiritual truths through situations children can relate to, teaching God's word to the children you love. Join the Superbook DVD Club and receive Superbook's newest episodes as they're available, plus two copies to share with others, all for your gift of only $25. Get Superbook today and watch the miracles happen.
Welcome back to our year in review. In March, a bishop from Argentina became the leader of the world's 1.2 billion Catholics. Pope Francis is the first pope from Latin America, and in a short time, he's changed the perception of the Catholic Church. He was even named Time Magazine's Man of the Year. A Vatican spokesman says Francis is not looking to be famous, but if the choice of Person of the Year helps spread the message of the gospel, a message of God's love for everyone, he will certainly be happy about that. His predecessor, Pope Benedict, stepped down in February, becoming the first pope to resign in more than 500 years. Iranian-American pastor Saeed Abedini and his family observed a grim milestone this year. In September, he marked 1 year in an Iranian prison. Abedini is serving an 8-year sentence for his Christian faith. Despite international pressure, the Iranian regime does not appear to be willing to release him. Earlier this year, I spoke with his wife, Nagmeh, about her efforts to release him and how the family is dealing with his imprisonment.
Their love story began in Iran. Nagmeh, an American citizen since early childhood, believed God was leading her to return to her homeland in 2001 to minister to Muslim women. That's where she first saw Saeed Abedini. The young preacher was leading worship at one of the underground house churches he helped form.
What made you fall in love with him?
His passion. I think as a young woman, I always prayed. I said, Lord, I can't marry someone who's mediocre. I want to marry someone who is passionate for you. But I had no idea how he would answer my prayer. I had no idea it would be so radical.
Not long afterwards, the two married in Iran. Their wedding drew hundreds of well-wishers and aroused the suspicion of the Iranian Revolutionary Guard.
Our wedding, our union was a miracle because we were both Muslim converts and they allowed us to have a Christian union. Bibles were passed out, Jesus film videos were passed out, and many people came to know Christ, hundreds.
But 9 years and two children later, 4-year-old Jacob and 6-year-old Rebecca, Nagmeh is now living her worst nightmare. Last July, during one of Saeed's routine trips to Iran to establish a government-approved orphanage, he was detained and put under house arrest. Then, in January, the Iranian Revolutionary Court, so-called hanging judge, sentenced him to 8 years in Iran's brutal and deadly Evin prison. His crime? Preaching the gospel. Nagmeh admits, at first, she sank into despair.
I was in the edge of extreme depression and anxiety, but the Lord didn't let me break. I clung to him and I cried out to him. I said, Lord, in Philippians, you promise you will give peace beyond understanding. And he gave me that peace.
In the meantime, the American Center for Law and Justice is going full throttle with both a legal and media campaign. Jordan Sekulow says publicity could be a lifesaver for Saeed, just as it was for Iranian pastor Yusuf Nardakhani. Nagmeh says she believes prayer, not government, will free her husband.
Do you believe you'll see him again?
I do. You know, it's the flesh versus the spirit. My flesh wants to say he's not going to survive that prison. But when I pray, I feel like the Lord, he's a God of hope. And he tells me that it's at his time he will release Saeed.
Christians in Iran face arrest, torture, even death. Some of those Christians have been seeking asylum in Sweden, but Swedish immigration officials are planning to send them back to Iran. That was the case of Iranian Christian Reza Jabari before a report from CBN's Dale Hurd turned it all around.
In March, CBN News brought you the story of Reza Jabari, who, along with many other Iranian Christians in Sweden, faced deportation back to Iran and grave danger.
The Swedish government's attitude toward Iranian Christians facing deportation would seem to be as cold as the Swedish winter. The Iranians say Sweden's immigration board simply does not care that they may face prison or torture if they're returned to Iran.
Jabari, a famous singer in Iran who refused to be a government informant, was hiding in Sweden after his asylum request was rejected, aware of what awaited him in Iran if authorities found and reported him.
In the Islam, it's Sharia. If every A Muslim man who leaves the Islam must be killed because this man is apostate.
His pastor, Kai Berger, still can't believe Reza's asylum request was denied.
And I thought, this should be a piece of cake. I mean, this man has brought other Muslims to the Christian faith and the Christian baptism. I mean, if he's a fraud, he's a very bad one. He's bringing people to a Christian faith. But still, they denied him. That made me look into what is going on.
What's going on, according to veteran Swedish immigration lawyer Gabriel Donner, is a badly run asylum process and, in some cases, anti-Christian bias.
When you apply for asylum, you have to present your case. If you claim that you are a convert, you need to show some evidence of having converted. Certificate of baptism, for example, membership in a congregation, or something else of that sort.
But Donner says that crucial evidence is often missing from asylum applications because too many state-appointed lawyers don't include it. Bengt Sjöberg spends his time trying to rescue Christian asylum seekers.
Almost every week, about five or six churches call me and say, these people who have come to church, they are real converts. They are members in our church, but Migration Board, they don't believe they are Christians. What shall we do?
But Reza's case has had a happy ending. The Swedish government now has decided to grant him permanent residency. And Reza's pastor, Kai Berger, says CBN's story about Jabari's situation changed the political climate for Christian refugees seeking asylum in Sweden. But other Iranian Christian refugees could still be in jeopardy, like Ali Matab and their girl Serena. They're Iranian Christians who left Islam and they now face deportation.
We have told our families in Iran that we are Christian now, and they have disowned us. So we don't have a family to return to. Our blood is now halal. It's holy for Muslims to kill us.
The good news is Reza can stay in Sweden, but other Iranian Christians are still in danger. Dale Hurd, CBN News.
Up next, when disaster strikes, the church strikes back, helping the people of the Philippines come back from two natural disasters.
Hello? Is this thing on? Hey, kids, do you love games? And do you love discovering things? Yeah! Well, do you?
Then you're gonna love this. It's the new free Superbook Kids Bible app. You can play games, watch videos, find answers to your questions, and a whole lot more. The new Superbook Kids Bible app. Free downloads available on iTunes and Google Play now.
CBNNews.com. News you want, when you want, 24/7. Stay current with up-to-the-minute stories.
Ephraim Graham, CBN News, New York.
I don't have to wait for my news anymore.
CBNNews.com, at your fingertips all day long.
I only watch the stories I want to see.
I find the story, I click on it, and boom, I'm there.
Embassy in Washington, Eric Stackelbeck, CBN News.
The source for your news, CBNNews.com.
Hello, I'm Terry Newsom. Did you know there are more than 148 million orphans in the world today? 148 million. But it was three little girls that taught me about the plight of orphans. 8 years ago, my husband and I spent nearly a month immersed in the daily activities of a Ukrainian orphanage as we waited to adopt three sisters. I saw firsthand the utter loneliness, the pain of rejection, and the overwhelming desire to be loved. That experience changed me forever. And out of it grew a ministry from my heart called Orphans Promise. Today, we're helping orphans and vulnerable children in more than 50 countries worldwide. Thousands of children are now in safe homes. They're being educated, and they're learning life skills. I'm asking you to join with me and become family to these children. Will you call the number on your screen right now? Because every child deserves a chance to be happy.
What a year it's been, especially for the Philippines. Just a month ago, the largest typhoon ever recorded hit the island nation. More than 6,000 are reported dead and more remain missing. For days, typhoon survivors were without food and water as relief teams struggled to reach them. CBN's George Thomas was with CBN disaster relief teams on the ground.
CBN News got an aerial view of the destruction left by Typhoon Haiyan.
As far as the eye can see, destroyed homes, trees completely flattened. Last Friday, the eye wall of Typhoon Haiyan came right here, made its first landfall in Giwan.
John Tan is CBN Asia's general manager.
Giwan was the first town hit by this powerful typhoon.
He says while most of the attention is focused on Tacloban, the hardest hit city just north of here, dozens of towns like Giwan are also struggling to cope.
And so we felt that we should help them.
CBN Disaster Relief and local partners delivered much needed food, blankets, tents, sleeping mats, and clothes.
So from today, we hope that we can continue to bring more goods on a daily basis.
Antonio Habrez is overseeing the emergency supplies coming into Giwan's destroyed airport.
Our food is scarce. We are isolated and it's hard to get to our city. But the food you've brought and other materials will be a big help.
Security is a big concern. The Philippine Army and police are on the ground to keep residents from looting and rioting.
The security is much better now that police from different parts of the country are here to watch over the town.
Grace Aman is among the hundreds of residents waiting at the airport to escape the chaotic aftermath of the storm.
I'm leaving my parents and my children here and going to Manila to get help from other relatives because we've lost everything.
5 days after the powerful typhoon ravaged large swaths of the country's midsection, many here are getting desperate.
I lost everything. What I am wearing today is all I have. I've been wearing the same clothes since the typhoon. This was our dining area. Over there was our bedroom.
Others like Steve have no other option but to stay.
I was in this corner like this. My child was next to me with a helmet on. My other child was in a container and my wife here in this corner.
Despite the challenges ahead, Steve says that he'll somehow find a way to rebuild because this is, after all, home.
We don't know where we go from here, but we are just thankful to God to be alive. So for now, we take one day at a time.
George Thomas, CBN News.
Some might have forgotten that a massive earthquake struck the Philippines just before that typhoon. The people of Boho Province are still struggling to recover from that quake. And you're about to meet a man who lost his son in that tragedy. But as Lucille Tolusin shows us, a happy memory caught on camera has given him hope and new life.
When the 7.2 magnitude earthquake struck, JR, his parents and sister ran towards his six-year-old nephew, Jael, who was then playing outside their house. He said they huddled together when suddenly the earth beneath them opened up. Rodel, JR's older brother, was away from home on business. He regrets not being there to rescue his son, Jael.
I should have been there beside my son to help him, but I was not able to do anything.
The horrific scenes from that day when JR and Rodel's loved ones were buried alive in this sinkhole are still haunting their minds. But believe it or not, a simple video of the animated series Superbook has now become their source of healing and hope.
Rodel surprised us when he showed a cell phone video of his son Jael and daughter Krisha singing the Superbook salvation song. The animated Bible series reached even this remote part of the Philippines and has become the favorite of a boy swallowed in the earthquake.
They asked me to record the salvation song from the television because they want to memorize the song. I like the show because it has made my children more respectful. They showed more affection and they prayed for all the members of our family every night.
I love Superbook because it's about the Lord. My brother was always excited to watch it with me. I know Jael is in heaven because Jesus saved him.
A CBN counselor explained the meaning of the Superbook song to JR and Rodel and invited them to accept Jesus as their Savior.
Now that I have accepted Christ,
I feel strong and whole, and I'm ready to face life again.
Change my life and make it new.
And these Filipinos now know that God's word and promises cannot be destroyed or shaken by even the strongest earthquake. Lucille Talusan, CBN News, Bohol, Philippines.
Come on, give me that. Bye. Sure, life is busy, but I found a way to make a huge difference in people's lives. I guess you could say I'm changing the world right here from home. I bring medical supplies and doctors to people in need and dig wells so that villagers can have clean and safe water to drink. I make it possible to preach the gospel in over 100 countries, including right here in America. And when disaster strikes, I'm there, providing food, thank you, and emergency supplies to give people hope again. Every day, CBN and I are making the world a better place. Here you go. My life is hectic, so I joined CBN through Pledge Express. My bank does all the work, and I know that my gift is being used where it's needed most. So become a CBN partner and join Pledge Express, because you can do a world of good right from where you are. Hi, good morning. Are you ready to get started?
If you had the opportunity to come before Almighty God to ask one question, what would that question be?
Well, I'd ask God, why is there so much suffering in the world?
What's my purpose in life?
I'd ask him, when will my wife recover?
How's the world gonna end?
I'd ask him, what's it all about?
I'd ask, how should we live our lives?
Pat gives you the biblical answers for life's most important questions. In the 700 Club's newest DVD, Pat Robertson teaches, How Shall We Now Live? You'll discover the purpose God has for you, why there is so much suffering in the world and the origin of evil, what heaven is like and how to know for sure you'll go there, how to live a blessed life and have a closer relationship with God, and much more.
We perish for lack of knowledge. If we understood what God wants to do, it would open up a whole treasure trove of opportunities for us.
Pat Robertson teaches How Shall We Now Live? Available now.
Finally this week, snow is a rare sight in the Middle East. This winter, a major winter storm hit Israel for the first time in years, bringing snow to the city of Jerusalem. Chris Mitchell tells us more.
The worst blizzard to hit the region in more than 50 years dumped nearly 20 inches of snow on Jerusalem over 3 days.
It's unbelievable. It's nice. We have drought. You need water. See? So it's very important to have snow and have water.
The historic storm stranded thousands of motorists on their way to Jerusalem. More than 35,000 Israeli homes were without power, some for days. But for many Jerusalemites, they were days of fun without work or school.
Because it's fun and you miss school and everything. You can make snowmen and eagles.
Many enjoyed the wonder of seeing the city of Jerusalem shrouded from what the Bible calls the treasuries of snow. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
Oh, it's majestic. Just love snow. Well, that's all for this year in review. Thanks so much for joining us. All of us here at Christian World News want to wish you and your family a very happy new year. And until next year, from all of us here, goodbye and God bless you.